Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another fantastic episode of Radio Days with Gary Music Miller. I'm your co-host, Dave Black. This is the infirmed one, as well as I am, is Gary Music Miller, longtime voice at WKEE. He was there for about 110 years. And anybody that's old enough to remember the time in memoriam remembers hearing him on the air. I am getting over a pretty nice cold. Unfortunately, I didn't keep the J.D. Sumner voice, which I had earlier in the week and wished I had.
Yeah.
It was pretty awesome.
It was hard to talk to you on the phone and realize it was you.
Yeah. At any rate, we are getting over. Well, I am getting over my infirmity, illness, whatever you want to call it. Gary's got the sniffles, so if you bear with us today, we might just get through this. I'm still suffering from a bit of a cough due to this thing. It's just an old-fashioned nasty head cold that's getting out of me,
and I've got these to dab with.
Yeah, we want to do is get through this as well as we can without making anyone else ill. So,
and we hope it'll be fun today.
So what's going on? Well, you got anything to talk about?
At the outset, let me just thank you for tuning in. You guys who are tuning in for the first, second, third time, we had a good increase in subscribers as of our last show, which featured the infamous Alligator Jackson, who is pretty much a Huntington guru. And he joined us, and we had an increase in views, and we had an increase in subscribers. So if you're just joining us for the second or third time, thank you. We hope you enjoyed. Please stay until the end of the show. We have a lot of segments. We're going to be looking, not to sniff, we're going to be looking inside Gary's vault, which has some stuff that you have requested. I had several requests for people asking me, do you have autographs or pictures that you carried with you from your radio days? And I'll share a couple of those at the end of every show until I run out. And today we're going to do something that Dave and I like to do when we're off camera. We talk about music, and he likes, especially, I don't think you mind me saying that, likes to talk about songs he doesn't like very much. We've decided not to use the word hate. We've decided not to use the word detest. Yeah. But these are songs that basically, we're going to go over. He's got 10 songs. I have 10 songs. You have 10, though.
Yeah. And you could have had many more.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like taking 2,000 songs and narrowing them down to 10. So I don't know what's on his list. He doesn't know what's on my list. We could very well have a disagreement between us, which would be fun. I think for us to go at it, how can you like that song? What are you talking about? We haven't shared the list, and we're going to share these with you today. As I said, we'll go in Gary's vault later, and I'm not sure what else we have planned. You may have a stump Gary.
I've got a couple of stump Garys. If you win one, I'm going to try to get you with another one.
Okay.
Probably get both of them anyway.
Try to stump me. I was on the radio, in case you don't know, from 1971 to 2010. And over a four-decade or so span, I have a lot of record information filed in the file cards of my brain. And somebody will mention a song, and I'll go, oh, my gosh, So Dave likes, I remember that song. I remember who did it. I haven't thought about them in years.
We were talking the other day, and I mentioned one that we haven't heard in ages.
Oh, and, my gosh.
Vidurus.
Roger Vidurus. Yeah, Roger Vidurus. Get used to it.
Yeah, well, I haven't heard that in so long.
What a wonderful song.
And heard it the other day, and I thought, well, that's just, you know, it's been since like the 80s or so since I heard
get
that.
Get used
thing.
To you. Yeah, no, great let song. Me down. You're going to turn me around. It, Roger Vidurus is the only song, so only hit that I know of. So
yeah.
So.
At any rate,
we ready to get into this?
You want me to lead off, or do you?
Yeah, that sounds fine. Okay. You lead off because you're going to have more songs that I like than I have songs that you like. Yeah. I have a feeling.
So for those of you who've just tuned in for the
I'm sorry. I just want to say we're not here to offend anyone. I'm going to mention some icons and iconic songs and iconic groups, and we're not here, you know, to make you mad or offend you. These are our picks only, and hopefully you'll answer us with where we made mistakes or what we eliminated at rdwgmm@gmail.com. That's how you get a hold of us,
right?
And you can write us both there and say you are crazy, that song was great, or you missed this song or whatever. So we really want, when I started the show, I said it's got to be a two-way street. I'll do this if you write me and talk to me. So that's where we are today. So Dave's going to start.
With all this said, now, before we go any farther, those of you that have tuned in to watch for the very first time, we welcome you with open arms. We hope you come back again. We'd like you to like, share, and subscribe, if you will. It just helps the channel out.
And if you're a brand new subscriber, which we have a few of, welcome back. Yeah, and this is an indication of what we do regularly.
Yeah, those of you who are existing viewers who are loyal to the program, we welcome you back as well.
Thank you
very much for supporting our channel.
Huge applause.
For this huge undertaking we go through. So with that said, I'm going to go now. These songs I've got here are not in any particular order. They're just songs I didn't care for that much, and some of them probably were big, huge hits, but I just did not like them at all.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we can. Do you want me to give the whole list, or go back and forth, or what do you want to do?
Well, we go back and forth.
Okay.
If you're number 10.
I'll start at my number 10, and you know as well as I do what this song is. It's not, they're not in any order. You know what this song is, and I just detested it from the day I heard it, didn't like it from the day I heard it.
Okay.
Nobody's Gonna Break My Stride by Rocky Burnett.
No. That was by Matthew Wilder.
Matthew Wilder. I'm sorry, not Rocky.
Rocky Burnett's coming up. I got
Rocky, Matthew Wilder. I'm sorry. I was looking at the wrong thing. But yeah, Break of My Stride, Matthew Wilder. It Break My Stride, actually, but he sang it Break of My Stride, and I just could not stand that song.
Do you remember the years on any of these?
I didn't write any of them down. They were in the 70s. My list came from the 70s.
Okay.
The 80s were just...
But he didn't like Break My Stride. I could take it or leave it. Yeah. That's me. I didn't detest it. I didn't hate it. I didn't turn it down when it came on. It was upbeat. It didn't turn me off.
He just sounded too whiny to me for some reason. I don't know.
Understood.
At any rate,
my number 10 song is almost all these songs are from 1974, which is interesting. I started in radio in 71. I went from a country station, WWHY, to WCMI in Ashland with Charlie Dunlap in 1974, and that's when I first got to play top 40 hit music. So a lot of these songs come from that era. My number 10 song, sorry, it's difficult for me to, You're Having My Baby by Paul Anka. Now, Paul Anka was a prolific songwriter. He had hits back in the 50s. He wrote My Way, which was a hit for both Frank Sinatra and Elvis Presley.
Thank you.
He wrote the theme to The Tonight Show. Prolific writer, but I'm sorry, You're Having My Baby. I mentioned this to my wife, and my wife said, "What a great song that is." You know, I'm sorry. To me, it's almost demeaning to the girl he's singing to. And the girl he's singing to later on in the song answers, "I'm having your baby."
Odia Coates.
Yeah, Odia Coates. She says, "I'm having your baby." And it's a lovely way to say how much I love you.
Lovely way to say child support.
Child support. Yeah. And you could, it's something about you could have had an abortion. You could have, you didn't have to do it, but you went through it or something. I'm sorry. I did not like that song. And I liked the follow-up, One Man, Woman, One Woman, Man, much better. And You're Having My Baby went to number one. So no offense to anybody having babies that likes that song, but that's my number 10.
Yeah.
And again, as Dave said, these could go in any order, except for my number one song, which sticks out. But
there was a tie. That's why I had a tie at number 10. I said Rocky Burnett, because I looked at that name first. Knew the Rocky Burnett song, Heart of All in a Line. I just could not stand that. It just didn't set well with me. And if he's tired of toeing the line, he just should stop it.
Whatever toeing the line means.
Yeah.
He knows I actually love that song.
Now, he wasn't dragging the line, but he was
dragging the line. He was towing the line that Tommy James drug. But I really, really like the song. And I tell you what, there's a genre, I guess, of music you could call rockabilly. And many people have called Rocky Burnett's dad, Johnny, went to number 8 with a rockabilly song. It's a cross between rock and hillbilly. And he went to number 8 with the original You're 16, You're Beautiful, and You're Mine, that Ringo Starr went on to remake. Funny thing about it is he went to number 8 with You're 16. Rocky Burnett went to number 8 with Tired of Towing the Line. And to me, it has a rockabilly feel to it. Now, you're right. The way he cracks his voice,
yeah.
I'm tired of towing the line. and we would inevitably sing, if you're going to dump on me, baby, baby, you can kiss my behind.
Yeah. I'd rather hear a rockabilly goat sing.
Yeah, rockabilly goat. But he hates the song. I really liked it when it came up. I liked the music, but it was a very definite throwback to the rockabilly days of his dad. So if you don't like that, then you're not going to like this song. So okay.
Next up, that was a tie. Of course, next on my list is, I almost hate to say it. It was so bad. Muskrat Love by Captain and Camille.
God, okay.
Oh, that was just such a hideous song to me.
I've heard
love songs.
You can
about
take my number 6 song off the list. That's number 6.
Well, I had Having My Baby on my list. So,
okay.
I've heard love songs about every single thing coming and going,
muskrat,
with the exception of muskrats. Now,
why a rodent?
Rodent sex and love is beyond me. I'm sorry, I don't get into it. And it's just one of those things that I can't.
Well,
I don't know.
This
was supposed to be a song for adults.
Do you know, you may not know this, but the song, first of all, was pitched to the iconic group. I mean, I absolutely love this group, America.
Oh, yeah, I've read that.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember that.
Muskrat Love. And I think America may have released it. Thankfully, they came along with A Horse with No Name, which I was lukewarm on, and I loved Ventura Highway. I thought Ventura Highway was a great, great song. And that may be on
their
list.
Did they just call it Horse? And they didn't have a name.
Had no name. Here's Horse. Mr. Horse.
Yeah, of course.
Hello.
Of course.
I'm Mr. Horse. Wilbur. But Muskrat Love deserves to be on the list. Okay. I agree with you wholeheartedly. It was my number 6 song. Let me get up to my number 9. 1974, by the way, was the year for Paul Anka. 1974 is also the year for Paper Lace, the night Chicago died. Don't like that song at all.
I don't really either. I just didn't have room for it on my list.
Well, what's interesting about it is Bo Donaldson is going to show up later in my list. And let me get this through my head here. The Night Chicago Died was a UK hit for Bo Donaldson and the Hayward. It was the first UK hit. No, I'm sorry. I'll get this right in a minute. Edit this whole part out.
We don't edit anything.
Night Chicago Died was the first UK hit by the group Paper Lace. And interestingly enough, they cross, because I think it was Paper Lace that did Night Chicago Died. And Paper Lace's first UK hit was Billy Don't Be a Hero. So I don't know how all that matches, but they kept their bad taste.
Everybody covers together. Things. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, are you done with that one?
I'm done. I'm done with Night Chicago Died. That was number nine.
Next on my list is I Can Help by Billy Swan. Hated it. Well, I shouldn't say that again. I disliked it very, very, very much. He's begging this chick for something. I can help, you know. It reminds me of the commercial where that kid said, and I helped. It just, you know. I can't remember the commercial now, but I know that. I remember the kid's voice.
Loretta Lynn did something, and she goes, today I helped, or whatever yeah. Helped.
Shake and bakes. Well, shake and bakes, what it was. And
I
helped.
It was Loretta Lynn.
It's exactly what it reminded me of, and I just never did like it.
Well, I'm with you 100%. It was a song that, you know, when the organ part starts, it was one that I did not particularly care for. I didn't
walking into a skating rink.
It's, yeah, yeah. It's
terrible.
Yeah. I can help. I can help. Number eight on my list is from 1974. Surprise, surprise. Terry Jacks, Seasons in the Sun. Is that on your list?
No, it is not. I don't have that one.
Didn't have that one. We had joy. We had fun. We had Seasons in the Sun. I don't know if it's about a guy that died. Goodbye to you, my trusted friend. We did something till the very end. I didn't like it. I'm sorry. It was a big hit. Seasons in the Sun. Terry Jacks. I think he was part of the Poppy family, which you may be getting ready to mention.
Him and his wife were in that group.
Him, the Poppy family did Billy. What Billy's? Which way you going, Billy?
They split up shortly after that.
And Terry did Seasons in the Sun, and I'm sorry, might be one of your favorite songs. I did not like it, so it made it on my list at number eight.
All right, next up for me is Anything by the Bay City Rollers.
Okay.
Anything they did, and anything that sounded like the 1910 Fruit Gun Company, I did not care for at all. So that takes in a few records that they released, but
I Only Want to Be With You, the remake. Yeah. They remade I Only Want to Be With You, which was whatever, but I didn't mind the Bay City Rollers any more than I minded Leif Garrett, any more than I minded Sean Cassidy. When I went to Key in 1978 from WCMI, I had to play a lot of those records, and they kind of stuck with me, and I didn't turn the monitor down when they came on. But I'm with you. I have no objections to what you're saying. Number seven on my list is from 1974. That's a terrible. That was my first year in Top 40 radio, and I'm coming up with all these songs, and I'm not really feeling them. 74, 75. I love love songs. I love ballads. I'm a ballad crazy person. I love them. This one went over the top for me. It went, you know, where A Love Song is right along here. This one tried to go way up here, and it's called Feelings, and it's by Morris Albert. And every time it came on, I was like, Feelings. Oh my God. Oh my God. I was like, you know, we would do the dental version of that. Fillings. Nothing more than fillings. And I think I got a rejection letter. I wrote that lyrics to that and sent it to Weird Al Yankovic and got a rejection letter. Yeah. I have 10 rejection letters from Weird Al Yankovic. But I'm joking about that, but I just didn't care. I'm sorry. Feelings is a beautiful song. I won't deny that, but it was over the top and not a very favorite song
for me. How many calls did you get after you played it and people asking you if you had Morris Albert in a can? I don't know.
but that is that came in at number 7 for me. Yeah. And
well, next
again, it could be anything.
Next on my list, you've already mentioned it. It's Paper Lace, Night Chicago Died.
Okay.
I already mentioned Muskrat Love. That was next on my list.
All right.
You already mentioned You're Having My Baby. That was next on my list.
So you gave those higher ratings than I did.
So, this is stuff that just came to mind as I went.
Okay.
So next on, and I just call me a heretic, whatever you want. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm going to be called.
I'm not anti children. I love children, especially if they're well cooked. However,
oh my God, I better know where you're going.
However, a song called is Playground in My Mind by Clint Holmes. It may as well be done by John Holmes. I hated this thing.
My name is Michael. I got a dolly or whatever the hell. I can't disagree with you on that.
Such a bad song to
playground,
me.
In the playground in my mind. I actually tried to tweet Clint Holmes and say, I played your song. I didn't really love it, but I played your song. I never got an answer from him, but I never got blocked by him either.
Oh,
but,
boy, that was such a bad thing. It made him sound like a big pedophile or something.
Bad. The playground in my mind.
Okay, go ahead.
My number 6, you've already talked about, Muskrat Love. Number 5 for me. I don't think we mentioned it. We did mention Bo Donaldson and the Haywoods, 1974. And that, like I said, their version of Billy Don't Be a Hero was the first a hit in England, in the UK, for Paper Lace, who did Night Chicago Dying, another one I dislike. But Billy Don't Be a Hero, I went to see... and I had to be reminded of this. I actually went to see Bo Donaldson and Haywoods at the Paramount Arts Center. My friend Jive Talk and JJ Joel Jackson reminded me that we went to see Bo Donaldson and the Haywoods. And I don't dislike the group. I did not care for the song. Sorry. I know it's got a message behind it, I think.
Yeah.
It probably is blasphemy to put this song down, but I didn't like it. I did, and I mentioned this in a previous broadcast we did on one-hit wonders that didn't have to be one-hit wonders. The follow-up to Billy Don't Be a Hero was a song called Who Do You Think You Are? And it's on YouTube, Bo Donaldson and Haywoods, Who Do You Think You Are? Listen to it. It's a great, great song. So nothing against Bo Donaldson, but I think the wrong song was a hit for them. So,
yeah.
And now we're getting up to the ones you're really going to hate too. What number are you at?
Oh, I'm up near the top of my list.
Okay.
I've got 2 left. And
Two left.
One of them has already been, both of them have been mentioned. But,
oh, boy. Okay.
You have mentioned Billy Don't Be a Hero. That was tops on my list. I couldn't stomach that one.
But okay.
My last one, there's probably more to come, was
by the Poppy family. You mentioned Where You Going, Billy. That must be a thing with Billy in the title.
Billy, don't be a hero.
Where You Going, Billy?
Where You Going, Billy?
I just did not.
Achy breaky heart, Billy.
Did not care for those two songs at all.
Sorry, forgive me for wiping my drip. But so your whole list has been covered?
Oh, yeah.
I still got four songs left. At number four on my list, I think it's the group's only number one song. And this is going to be blasphemy to a lot of people. You're gonna hate me. But I did 1974. I'm pretty sure it was their first number one song. The Doobie Brothers. The Doobie Brothers' Black Water. Now, I can't explain why I didn't like that song, but I like songs like Listen to the Music, Long Train Running. I like their up-tempo stuff. And when they got into Black Water, it just irked me. I'm sorry, I did not care for Blackwater, and I won't go into any more than that. The number three song is from 1970. I think it's from 1970. I'm not sure. It's about my favorite group of all time. Dave knows my favorite group of all time, don't you? Or do you?
Three Dog Night.
Three Dog Night, absolutely. And I love them so much. I found out they were appearing in a barn in Paintsville, Kentucky. I got off the air at 6 o'clock that evening, and I made my wife go to the show. We drove to Paintsville to see Three Dog Night, and the worst song they ever did to me is their number one song, the only number one song I think they had, and that's Joy to the World.
Yeah.
I just don't like Joy to the World. When I hear it, I will turn down the radio, leave, or turn down the TV, leave, come back. I did not like Joy to the World. I'm sorry. I'm talking about the version Three Dog Night did. I'm not talking about the religious Christmas song,
No. But
I did not care for it. Number two, I'm going to get hate mail on, and that's what I want. I'm not getting any mail at all. I want your hate mail. Number two goes from 1968 to 1971, I believe. Any song by Creedence Clearwater Revival. Sorry to offend you. I did not like CCR at all. I've heard all of their hits. I've not found a song that I like. I don't know whether it's because they had kind of a country sound to them. They had nothing against the Fogertys, the Fogerty family or anything, but any song by CCR, I don't like CCR. And I have the right not to like them, even though you may love them. And let me have hell about that. My number one song all time, this one I did detest. I did detest this song. I did not like it when I had to play it. And I think it was a top five, maybe even a number one. It came out in 1975, surprise. The song was called At 17, and it's by Janice Ian. And anytime I played that song, I turned the volume down on the monitor. I listened to the song all the way through. I thought, this just, it's not a hit. There's nothing about this. And again, it's probably a message song. It's like an anthem to women, and I don't dislike women at all, but I just don't like At 17 by Janice Ian. And if you mention to me, what song do you hate or do you not like the most out of all the songs you played, that's the one that I just didn't understand why it became a hit. It had no beat, it had no rhythm. I've talked about how much I like disco songs, and this came out at the beginning of the disco era, And we needed other songs besides the disco songs, but Janice Ian's At 17 is my least favorite song of all time. And I apologize to anybody on the
Wow.
So.
Well,
that's the fun list. We thought we'd try that out.
And believe me, I could have added 20 more of them, or many more than to this list than I have.
This is not all inclusive, except probably for my number one. And this was made rather hurriedly. We, you know, a lot of times I spend days on things. I didn't have the time to look up every song that's ever been released. So I did this rather hurriedly.
I have a couple of honorable mentions.
Sure.
That I didn't even write down.
Okay. And that reminds me of something I want to say.
Go ahead. Like it or not, I did not care for Rupert Holmes' Pina Colada song. Hated it. Just didn't like it. And didn't care for the next one, Him. This bad to me. This terrible song. People might like him. You people out there might like him.
I'm sorry. What is Him? Rupert Holmes' follow-up?
Yeah, I think he did a song called Him after that.
I don't remember that at all.
I can't stop. But he did a song called Him, and it was like in the early 80s, and it was just hideous.
Well, it, Cat in the Cradle's one, they're great. They're okay songs for me. I didn't mind the Pina Colada song, but you hear it once, it's like watching The Sixth Sense over and over and over and over. No spoiler warning: the guy's dead. The guy's dead. I probably get a lot of mail on that, but you can watch. I actually watched Sixth Sense twice, just to catch what I missed first time I watched it. And but Cats in the Cradle's one, it's a story song. You hear it once, you've heard the story, you understand the kid is now treating the father like the father treated him. Pina Colada song, Escape, I believe was the name. They're unhappy with each other. They put classified ads in to meet somebody, and they find out the people that answered their classified ads were
them,
their husband and wife. And once you hear that song,
I had another one on my list. Now, people, believe me, the Rolling Stones, one of the greatest of all time. Their song Angie, I had to turn it off when that came on. I just did not care for it. I don't know if it was the sound or the music, whatever it was, didn't set well with me, and I never did like that one either. But I'll stop there and leave it.
Well, I need to add something, and this is an interesting story. I think this, you story lovers, who I've had people write and say, you tell a good story. This is an interesting story. But we have to go way up in time to 1987. 1987, I'm music director, and I was helping the program directing at the time. And in 87, I get a single on a pink label. It was a little label. I don't know the label, and I don't know anything about the group. I think they came from the Midwest. I dropped the turntable on it, the turntable needle. I didn't drop the whole turntable on it, but dropped the needle down on it, listened to it. It was called I Think We're Alone Now, and it was by a group called Relation Inc. If you bring this up on YouTube, you'll be able to hear it. And the guy's comments, I believe it's called... He's called something, something New York. The guy's comments echo my sentiments exactly. Right after I got I Think We're Alone Now by Relation Inc. and played it a couple of times because I thought it was a hit, Tiffany comes along, and Tiffany Waddish or something is her last name. Tiffany comes along with I Think We're Alone Now. And believe it was MCA Records came into my office, brought the record, said, "You got to hear this." And I listened to it, and I thought it was, do I dare say, garbage? I did not like it at all. And I said, well, whoever the guy was I was talking to, "I'm actually playing another version of this song." "No, no, 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 no," he said. "You can't do that. This is the one that's going to be the hit. This is going to be a hit. That nobody's ever going to hear that song." So I ran it like 5 nights straight. I think my buddy Jason Dean, Jim Allen, was the night guy. And at 8 o'clock, we would have a battle of the bands, so to speak. We would battle one song against another. And on five different occasions, and you can't say I didn't give this a chance, I battled Tiffany versus Relation Inc. And Relation Inc. won 80-20 every time. So I talked to my consultant and I said, "I got a problem here. I'm playing a song that's not a hit, that is much better than the song that I believe is a hit. And the record company is really, 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 really pressuring me to play this song, because we reported our playlist to national magazines like Billboard and Radio and Records. And every time a record went up at a radio station, it went up on the R&R or Billboard chart." And the guy's name was Steve Perrin. He lives, he worked at a radio station called in Kansas City. And he was my consultant at the time. And I'll never forget what he told me. He said, "Gary, if it's working for you, then screw what the record company has to say. Screw it. Don't play the Tiffany version if it's not working for you. And you're getting 20 calls a night, and 16 of them or 18 of them or 14 of them are for Relation Inc. You need to play the Relation Inc. version." So I played Relation Inc., and I have to mention that because I, to this day, do not like the Tiffany version at all. And Relation Inc. can be found. Relation Inc., I think we're alone now, can be found on YouTube. And the comments, the guy says, he says, "What a great song. This was a true, I will never understand," the guy starts out, "I will never understand listeners' preferences." And he said he listened to this song and played it in a club. He started in radio in 1981, I think he said, and he absolutely loved this song. And then in the middle of his tirade, he says, "And then came Tiffany." And Tiffany was what ended up being the hit song.
Yeah.
So if anybody that knows Relation Inc., tell them to call me or write me or something. And it was so popular, Tom Roberts, a friend of ours, ran a club called the Derby Club. And I walked in one night and Tom asked me, he said, "Where can I find that version of I Think We're Alone Now that you're playing?" And we rounded up an extra version, and he put it on his jukebox, and it was really, really big. So it really beat the Tiffany thing. So that's a record I didn't like from the later years. That was about 1987.
I'm very surprised. I just thought of this. I'm very surprised you didn't have Telephone Man on your list.
Well, I considered it a novelty.
Yeah, I didn't have any novelties on mine either.
Yeah, we decided to center in on hit songs that were actual hit songs that weren't novelties. You know, Mr. Jaws, Disco Duck, Convoy could all be, you know, The Streak could all be on that list.
Convoy on one list was voted as the worst song of the 70s.
Well,
But it was a smash.
Yeah, it was.
C.W. McCall was a pseudonym. I can't remember the guy's name now. If it's escaping me, I had him in my head now. Left, of course.
Yeah,
but
was not his real name.
That was. I think he released one more, and that was it. But that song was a smash, and
it was a smash
one,
because CB Radio was the
That was the cell phone of the 70s.
It was there, yeah. I actually, the very first time I ever was actually on the radio, I was on a walkie-talkie and hooked up, I believe it was channel 19, and I hear a guy's voice, and he's a truck driver. And we talked for a few minutes. Here I am, like 16 years old, and we talked, and it wound up totally different had it been today, but we talked, and CB radio was in.
That was probably
Smokey and the Bandit,
which
I went to see 18 times.
Oh, my God.
Smokey and the Bandit, I absolutely loved. Jackie Gleason.
Well, are you ready to be stumped?
I'm ready to be stumped.
Okay, do you want to wait and show your things, or do you want to get stumped last?
Well, yeah. What do you think? You want to stump me last?
Yeah, I'll stump you last. Let's just wait on a second.
Let's dig into Gary's vault. These are things that got signed, or letters, or pictures that I've not shared with people. And people wrote me and asked me, I had more than one write me and say, do you have any pictures? Do you have any autographs? These people you met. And I do have some info on people you've never heard of, so and people you have heard of. So to begin with, let's start with Meryl. If you want to hold this up to the camera, she's not a bad looking girl.
Oh, I thought you meant Mel Torme.
Her name is Meryl Bainbridge. The only Meryl I ever knew was Meryl Steuben from The Love Boat. But
let me get this up here.
If you can get that up there, there's Meryl Bainbridge. And what's the writing on it say? Love you, Gary, or something like that?
To Gary with love.
To Gary with love.
Meryl Bainbridge.
Meryl Bainbridge. Meryl Bainbridge was a pop singer-songwriter from Australia. Her debut 1994 single, Mouth, was number one in Australia for 6 weeks. And it hit the U.S. top five. It was released in the U.S. in 1996. The success that it had in Australia led Universal Records to take notice of it. And in 1996, they released Mouth by Meryl Bainbridge, which went top 10 in the U.S. It peaked at number... I can't read my own writing. It either peaked at number 4 or number 9 on the Billboard Hot 100, and it became one of radio's most requested songs, Mouth by Meryl Bainbridge. Yeah. If you don't remember that, you might be a nice looking lady. She came by the station, and they brought the record, and they wanted to make it a big hit here in the United States, and they did okay with
We talked about Mouth and McNeil once. So
we did. Well, that. The song was called Mouth. There's a lot of mouth sound effects. It's just interesting to hear. Next guy I'm going to talk about, I have never talked about before, is Martin Page. Now, that name is anything but a household name. Let me read you a resume. Have a seat here.
I was going to wait until you hold that up there.
Yeah. Let me read some resume things and see what you think. He collaborated with Kim Carnes on her 1983 album, I believe it was, Cafe Racers. He collaborated with Earth, Wind, and Fire on their 1988 album, Electric Universe. He collaborated with Barbara Streisand on her 1984 album, Emotion. He played the keyboards on Ray Parker Jr.'s Ghostbusters. That, to me, puts him up here somewhere. In 1986, he did Ghostbusters, and he wrote songs including, he wrote We Built This City by Starship. 1985 album was called knee-deep in the hoopla. And We Build This City was his writing. He wrote These Dreams by heart. Beautiful, beautiful song. January 1986. And he wrote that, I believe, with Elton John's songwriting partner, Bernie Taupin. And he had many more collaborations. He co-wrote King of Wishful Thinking and Faithful. Do you remember the group?
King of Wishful Thinking?
Yeah. King of Wishful Thinking.
Go West.
Go West.
Go West.
Absolutely. Go West. He wrote those.
Well, I said go East.
Go East. Yeah.
Well, Horace Greeley once said, go West, young there's man, a, go West. And half the people in Seattle line. Fell in the ocean.
We might want to be bleeped out for this, but there's a line in it. I know my ship's not sinking.
Yeah. And well, we know what you're going to say.
Should I say?
I think we should keep it PG.
The word that sounds like ship is not stinking. That's yeah. what we rewrote that word. In 1994, the guy's name is Martin Page, and in 1994, he decided to go solo. And I've never mentioned him before because I knew people didn't really know who he is.
Let me get up again. There we go.
In 94, the record rep for the record company, it's probably at the bottom of there, I've forgotten the name of the record company.
Mercury.
Okay. The Mercury rep, myself, my wife, and our program director were supposed to have dinner with this. I mean, you got to call this guy a superstar, even though you don't know his name. He rolled into town because he was beginning a solo career, and he released a single called In the House of Stone and Light. I believe the song went top five, if not number one, on the adult contemporary chart, and it went top 15 on the Billboard Hot 100 chart. Martin Page has a resume, as I just read, that is untouchable. And he was supposed to be there. It ended up being me, the record rep, and the guy from the record company, and Martin Page. And we had a wonderful dinner at Route 60 East. What was the name of the restaurant that J.D. B's was in? The Holiday Inn, I believe.
I don't remember right offhand.
Okay. It was a Holiday Inn on Route 60 East, I believe. It was a great dinner, and I got to have dinner with him. And he wrote this, you might have seen this, he wrote it to Kim. I told him, we sat down for dinner and had lovely conversation, incredible conversation with this guy who's done everything and worked with everybody under the sun. And I said, my wife was supposed to be here. And I said, but she's sick. I don't know why the program director didn't come. He just kind of blew it off, I guess. My apologies if he's watching this. But my wife couldn't come because she was sick. And he said, where's the phone? And I can't recall whether there were cell phones in 1994 or if he got a phone brought over to the table. But I think it was the Gateway Holiday Inn was the name of the place. Mm-hmm. They bring him a phone. He called, and actually I got my mother-in-law was on the line. I said, get Kim. She said, she's not feeling well. I said, I know she's not. She's not with me right now, but get her to the phone. So Kim came to the phone, and this very British fellow, he had a British accent, talked with my wife and said, I'm so sorry you're not here tonight. And he autographed this picture to Kim, and it says, feel better, lots of love, you sound like a lovely lady, and Gary is a wonderful guy. Love and smiles, Martin Page. So that's something from Gary's vault.
If he's related to Jimmy Page.
He's just a page. Yeah. He's just a page in the book.
I knew a girl named Page once.
Well, if she'd have married him, she would have been Page.
I've known her since she was a paragraph.
Oh, so. Okay. That was a joke. This is my final offering. This is something you older guys are gonna enjoy. This is Carl Wilson. What does Carl say on that? To Gary, thanks for listening, I believe.
Yeah, to Gary, thanks for listening.
Carl Wilson. Carl Wilson was one of the original Beach Boys. In fact, he was their de facto leader. I think he was the baby brother of Dennis and... who was the other Wilson?
Brian.
Huh?
When Brian, was it?
Brian, yeah. How could I forget Brian Wilson? Brian and Dennis, and Carl was the baby brother. And Carl is the one singing lead on Good Vibrations, God Only Knows. He sang lead on Kokomo. So this will hopefully impress or interest our older viewers who know the Beach Boys from their string of 60s hits. And Carl decided to embark on a solo career in the, I believe, early 80s. And he sent me that picture. I never met him, but he sent me that picture and wrote to it, thanks for listening. He embarked on a solo career. It did not work out for him. Later on in 1988, I'm pretty sure, Kokomo became a number one song, I think, because of its exposure in Cocktail, I do believe.
And I thought he was Tim Taylor's neighbor
from Home Improvement. So there's an autographed picture I cherish from Carl Wilson. And Carl died tragically from lung cancer, I believe, back in 1992. So he's no longer with us, but his picture and his autograph live on in my thing. I do have one other thing to show. This is not really a Gary's Vault thing. This, if I can get it out, I had it actually framed in my old house. I'm not going to go into the story of what happened to our house in 2012, but we lost our house to a drunk driver in 2012. And this is one of the pictures that made it. And the reason I'm bringing it up is because we've had lots of Huey Lewis pictures. And this is simply because on the very far right of the picture, leaning in, and maybe the left as we look at the picture, but as I'm looking at it right now, to the right is Rick Swan, Steve Norman, great guy, Dave knew him.
Oh, yeah.
And there are two gentlemen in the middle. Then there's Huey Lewis, there's me, and there's the record rep from Huey's label, Chrysalis, I believe. But I do not know the names or cannot identify the two guys in the middle. There's a guy down below, looks like he's bent down below Rick Swan there, who's on the end, and the guy up above him. And I would love to know who those guys are. I'm sure they're probably programmers because we were in Charleston. I'm sure they were probably programmers in Charleston. But if anybody knows them on the West Virginia Broadcast History Board, you can mention who they are and if they're still around for us.
I feel like I should be doing the John Walsh spot here. If you can identify these men.
And that's exactly what it's like. And so that's Gary's Vault for this week. And
All right. You ready to get stumped?
I'm ready to get stumped, and we're ready to wrap this up.
And I promise you, it's probably not going to happen. But
yes,
anyway, let me start with the first one.
Okay. If you'd have mentioned him.
Yeah.
Was that the name of the song?
Yeah.
Which, if Reba McEntire had sung, it would have been Hilm.
Hilm.
Yeah. I'm not making fun of Reba, but Reba always finds a way to add an L into most of her one syllable words, and Hilm, Velm, whatever. But I love Reba. I love Aretha. Okay, go for it.
Okay. In 1984, this guy had two songs that hit the charts. One peaked at number 4, one peaked at number 29.
Wow.
I'm going to tell you the name of who gets credited for the song. And you tell me either one of the songs.
I'm credited
for Sergio Mendes. And it wasn't Brazil 66 or Brazil 77 at that time, because he changed it in 1988 to Brazil 88. But anyway.
Well, I know Sergio Mendes had a hit song called Alibis.
Mm-hmm.
Alibis, your alibis are watertight.
That peaked at number 29.
That was number 29.
Right.
And he had a song number 4, huh?
Mm-hmm.
You may have me stumped on that. I'm thinking. I know Herb Alpert, who he worked with, did Rise about 77, I guess. Sergio, it's not coming to me. I think you stumped me. I do remember it Alibis. Was, I would have thought Alibis would have been the bigger
thought that,
of the
I thought
marks.
That one was going to be the one that got you, too. You sure you can't think of it? I'm going to give you 10 more seconds.
Sergio Mendes, top 4 hit. Take my glasses off to think. Usually you do the opposite. Yeah, time's up.
Never going to let you go.
Never going to let you go.
Yep, never going to let you go.
I did not. You know
wow.
what? Yeah, I would have known the song.
There's a first.
I mean, I do know. That's a first.
Now,
never
going to
let you go. I didn't realize that was so
good. Can you tell me who actually sung it?
I would guess it would be somebody like Jeffrey Osborne.
No,
or,
it was sung. Both songs were sung by a guy named Joe Pizzullo.
Oh, Joe Pizzullo.
Yeah.
Wow.
Great song, great voice. Never Gonna Let You Go is a really big song.
Never Gonna
in
84. Let You Go.
Yeah. I'm going to give you this other one to let you redeem yourself. You'll probably get this.
Well, sorry. I remember the song. I did not remember that was
in 1982, this one peaked at number 19 on the Hot 100, peaked at number 3 on AC. Now, it was done by Carla Bonoff.
Oh, man, I think you got me. I think you got me.
A song I really liked. I was surprised it didn't go any farther.
Carla Bonoff.
Yeah, or Bonoff. Bonoff. But,
I don't even remember her name. I think you got me stumped.
Well,
it was a big AC song.
Mm-hmm.
Is it more than one word?
One word.
One word. Well, you can't give me the first word to give me a hint.
Yeah.
Well, folks, he did it to me twice. What was the name of
Personally.
Carla Bonoff's songs?
Personally.
Personally?
Yeah.
By Carla Bonoff.
Yeah. Good song.
And what was the year?
1982.
Yeah,
82.
I'd have to go back and listen.
She's a great singer, great voice. It just didn't go any higher than 19 on the Hot 100.
Well, it did not go to the top 19 in my mind. So,
most of you people out there watching this live your whole life without seeing an absolute miracle. Right now you've witnessed 2.
Yeah.
Because I got him twice. Mark this down on your calendars. It's probably the only time this will ever happen.
I know never going to let you go. I did not know of Sergio Mendes.
Yeah.
I do not remember Carla Bonoff personally.
Okay.
Personally, I don't remember.
Well, personally, I don't either.
Interesting story. When This Is Us came on, Mandy Moore was one of the stars of This Is Us. And the first time it came on and I saw Mandy, I leaned over to Kim and I said, I interviewed her. And I did. Mandy, if you look up Mandy Moore, I'd say probably early 80s, sometime in the 80s, she had a song. I don't even remember what it was, but she had a song that we played. And because we played it, we interviewed her. And I got the opportunity to interview her. And there's another girl named Jamie Lynn Siegler who had a moderate song that I also got to interview. So it's fascinating when you see somebody on the tube and you think, I talked to her.
Yeah.
So,
well, is that it?
That's all I can think of. Thank you for bearing with me through Gary's vault, and we'll do another one next time. Thank you for bearing with us as we mention our 10 least favorite songs, not in any particular order, and you CCR and having my baby fans, feel free to write me and tell me I'm crazy, or tell me what we left off the list.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can get a hold of him at rdwgmm@gmail.com.
And that's the best way, because
you can leave
read
comments,
all those and I answer.
Leave comments below the video down there. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm going to ask you to, if you would like, share, and subscribe. It helps the channel.
Thank you to the new subscribers.
Absolutely.
I think we went from 94 to 99. It didn't sound like a whole lot, but we're, you know, a little DJ that's been out of work for what? Since 2009, 15 years now.
That's a long time.
I've been off the radio. So I appreciate you people who remember me and who listen and who enjoy nostalgia, because we're all about nostalgia, records, singles, albums, concerts, radio, DJs. If you have a DJ you'd like to see me interview, send me their name. And if they're still around, I'll try to get a hold of them.
Yep, and as always, we're coming to you from the Museum of Radio and Technology here in Huntington, 1640 Florence Avenue. Get out here and take a look around at this place. If you can, give them a donation.
It's wonderful. It's fantastic.
You would love this place. It's absolutely fantastic. So, with that said, we are going to ski-daddle out of here.
We are, and I want to tell you that every time I come into this museum, I see something different, see something new. It's amazing. And I want you, I'm talking to you, to be our 100th subscriber. We got 99. Just subscribe. And if you watch and you listen and you like what we're doing and you remember me or remember Classic Key, please subscribe. That's all I have to say.
All right. With that said, we wish everyone a great day and good health. We'll see you next time around. God bless.